Members, thank you. This is the panel on manpower. We have a quorum and this is the appointed time. So I call to order this meeting. Item 1 on the agenda. Information papers issued since the last meeting. The Secretariat issued the following two papers to members after the last meeting. First, CB bracket 2643/1718 bracket 01. Letter dated the 4th of January 2018 from Dr Fernando CHEUNG, who suggested the panel discuss matters relating to the employees of contract out service by the government. And the second one is CB bracket 2670/1718 bracket 01. It's a joint letter dated the 8th of January 2018, again suggesting that the government discuss the government contractors and safeguarding employees' rights. And these are actually listed on item 17 of the list of items for discussion. So they are scheduled to be discussed in the second quarter of 2018. The Secretariat has also asked the administration to provide a written response. Whereas for the interdepartmental unit responsible for this area of work, they have begun reviewing the situation. And we will also invite the representatives. Yes, Dr. Anne Chang.
謝謝主席, 就你剛剛講...
Thank you, Chairman. Now, you were referring to safeguard measures to protect employees of government contractors, and we should also review the whole system. The DAB has also made the submission. Chairman, would you please confirm that? I haven't seen the paper at this moment, but I believe that they are being processed at the moment. Now, don't worry, I'm not going to proceed to the second item yet. I just want to share with you that I'd like to discuss this item as soon as possible instead of waiting till the second quarter. So when we come to the next item, we can invite the Secretary to respond whether it is possible to discuss this item at the next meeting. Please wait.
Okay, 好, 另外呢, 就,
now, the Secretary will not be coming in right away to answer members' questions because his item is not the next one. Dr. KK Kwok, about the next meeting, we discussed mandatory leave for employees with occupational injury. That's item 2. That's not the same as occupational diseases. It's still on item 22 of the list. So it's not scheduled yet. Would you pressure them? I'll try my best because, well, Chairman, you know that for employees, this is really a nightmare for them. After they got injured at work, they cannot go back to work. And for the Labour Department and the insurance companies, they are unable to help them. I'd like to discuss this issue as soon as possible. Will Chairman please talk to them? Because if there is no proposed timing at all, I'm afraid that it will never be discussed. Dr. KK Kwok, we have been following up on the issue, but the Secretary hasn't given us any response yet. It's really difficult to pressure them. Mr. Michael Lok. Thank you, Chairman. About the laying off of contract employees, the loopholes, and also employees who have not worked for the first 3 months will not be deprived of statutory or public holidays, or that their wages will be deducted. I hope this will be discussed as soon as possible as well. And also, when we met with Mr. Lau Chi Kwong, the Secretary, yesterday, He said that in terms of layoff, he would like to adopt the approach of a gratuity. I hope he would attend our meeting as soon as possible so that we could also consult the views of the labor sector. Dr. Hon Cheung. Now, the secretary won't be coming today. So how about on behalf of the panel, you discuss with the administration about the review of the government contracting service so that we can advance the discussion of the item to February instead of the second quarter, because second quarter means April, May or June, because we have Hoi Lai, Oilman Estate. These incidents are just the tip of an iceberg. We want to find out the whole picture. Perhaps this problem exists in all HA estates. For these contract employees, there are over 50,000 of them. Thank you, Dr. Hon Cheung. We've actually moved on to the next item because the next meeting is scheduled for the 26th of February 2018, Tuesday in the morning, 10:45 a.m. Well, we originally proposed to discuss two items. First, enforcement of labor legislation by the Labor Administration Branch of the Labor Department. That's item 21 on the list. And also, occupational disease and occupational health situation in 2017. That is item 18 on the list. And I'd like to seek members' views, because before the meeting, about government contracts, I already liaised with the secretary. I also requested that we discuss it as soon as possible. And recently, we received a reply from the secretary stating their agreement to discussing this issue on the 26th of February. The full name is the Safeguards for Employees Employed by Government Service Contractors, and this will be discussed as the first item next meeting. And because of this addition, item B here, that is for occupational diseases, they will be discussed at the next meeting. I mean the subsequent meeting to the next. I support that because we're all concerned about contract employees. We hope that the secretariat can shuffle the agenda, make sure that time is sufficient for the discussion. Mr. Peng Xiuping, the next regular meeting is scheduled in the morning of the 26th of February. It should be Monday instead of Tuesday, but this will clash with the panel on public services. I understand that, but since the new year is approaching, the meetings may get all bunched up. Or you have to dash between meetings. And I thank Mr. Peng Xiuping for the reminder. That was a suggestion. We discussed contracting first before we discussed enforcement of labor legislation. Do we agree with the Bureau's suggestion? No? All right, so that will be the agenda for the next meeting. Next item, item 3. Please raise your hand if you intend to speak. Third item, establishment of a human resources planning and poverty coordination unit under the Chief Secretary for Administration's private office. Let's invite the administration in. CB bracket 2671. /1718 bracket 03. So may I invite Ms. Kwan, Angelina Kwan, Head Policy and Project Coordination Unit, to walk us through the paper. Thank you. Chairman, on behalf of the Chief Secretary for Administration's private office, we're here to submit a proposal on an establishment of a unit, and that is the Human Resources Planning and Poverty Coordination Unit to help the Chief Secretary in the planning matters. And the paper covers the creation of two supernumerary posts, one D2 and D3, two directorate posts as head and deputy head of the Human Resources Planning and Poverty Coordination Unit, or HRPPCU. And in this term of government, the chief executive would like the government to take up the role of a facilitator, and there should be strengthened internal coordination and cooperation in the government so as to enhance efficiency of policy implementation. Under the CS4A's private office, this new unit will be assisting the CS for coordinating three matters. First, on human resource planning. And in fact, it's mentioned in the CE's election manifesto, as well as the other matters, and a new commission for the planning of human resources, CPHR, will also be set up to assess the need for human capital in Hong Kong so that we implement planning and training for cultivating talents. And in terms of flow of information, human resources planning, the commission will make recommendations to the government. And it will also subsume work of the steering committee in the previous government with adjustments to policies. The other arena of work is on poverty alleviation. All along, we have the Commission on Poverty, a high-level platform under the leadership of the Chief Secretary. After reorganization, under the leadership of Chief Secretary for Administration, we have launched policies as well as made efforts across bureaus and departments. And we will continue to with the work under the CS's coordination. In terms of inter-bureau, inter-departmental cooperation, it will provide support. And apart from the government, there will also be collaboration and coordination with the stakeholders outside the government so that we can provide one-stop service for the relevant stakeholders to give their views to the government. And there are also a number of committees, the Steering Committee on Population Policy and the Commission on Poverty, and the HRPPCU will provide secretariat support to the CPHR and the COP. Third area of work, we would like to engage the public and enhance the accessibility of information in the society, and also to promote exchange of information. So publicity is important. The HRPPCU will also help in this regard. Apart from these two directorate posts, there will also be 10 civil servants from different grades and departments to provide assistance. This will be a time-limited post, which will lapse on the 30th of June 2022. Coterminous with the current term of the government. And that concludes my briefing. We welcome questions from members. Thank you, Ms. Kwan. We have members who would like to ask questions, starting with Dr. K.K. Kwok, Andrew Wen, and Anne Chang, Michael Lok, and UC Wing. Each will be given 4 minutes, questions and answers included. Dr. K.K. Kwok. Well, in fact, the last term, these two posts were created. But unfortunately, say for poverty alleviation, in the last administration when Carrie Lam was the Chief Secretary for Administration, she was in charge of the Commission on Poverty, and she engaged Professor Kwan to conduct a consultancy study on retirement protection. And if Professor Kwan's views were heeded by By now, we should have implemented universal retirement protection. However, the government has gone back on their words, and the government started another consultation process, following which the government said no to universal retirement protection. And now we no longer discuss universal retirement protection or retirement protection at all. Now you want to create two more posts? How are you going to honor your promises? The last term of government, we've seen how the government failed to do that, even cheating the scholar. So don't waste our money and don't cheat the Legislative Council.
Professor Kwan put together two reports. So what are you going to do with them? What will you do about universal retirement protection? Well, if you are creating these new posts and you're still not doing anything, then I won't accept it. It's not that we don't have money. You know, the financial secretary has a hard time considering how to hand out goodies. But for the elderly, many of them cannot enjoy retirement benefits, and the housewives are also like that. I think for the retirement protection regime in Hong Kong is really flawed. So if you have this office, how are you going to honor your promises? Last time Mr. Lau Chi Kwong was here, he said that no matter how you scold me, I won't do it. So will you tell us that you're not going to do it, and why do you want to create this post? Ms. Kwan? Well, for Mr. KK or Dr. KK Kwok's questions, yes, it's about Professor Nelson Chow's reports. For the last COP, it spent a lot of time on Professor Chow's reports. We have considered different options. Earlier on, we had a public consultation and we have collected a lot of views. Now when we look at the reports, there are two options, and there are people supporting these two options. We also have an independent consultant who's doing the analysis of opinions for us. So we have collected views, and for the last government before the term ended, it launched a number of measures to optimize retirement protection. For example, our elderly living allowance is now improved, and the monetary authority has put together an annuity program. So there are a number of measures to help the elderly. So that is already the government's position. So you won't do it, right? So we will continue with these measures. We will monitor the situation, and then we will look at the progress of such optimized measures. So this was what the last government did concerning retirement protections. There have been a number of optimization measures. The last government has never promised that there will be a universal retirement protection scheme, and we just promised that we will review it, and we have launched some improvement measures. So we will have to look at the effect of these measures and then the COP will help the CS do this kind of work. Well, Ms. Kwan, you have to understand that for the elderly in poverty, the number has been increasing. So there are more and more poor people in Hong Kong, but you're telling us that you just have these measures in place. So what do you create this post for, Chairman? So she's telling us that for this term of governments, they would not do anything about universal retirement protection, right? Ms. Kwan has already told you this is the government's policy. If the CS doesn't ask her to do it, she cannot do it. Mr. Andrew Wan, Ms. Kwan is a very good civil servant. Well, I think for the 7 million people of Hong Kong, they have witnessed the swaying attitude of the government. I would like to ask another question. So we will mainly be focusing on population policy and poverty alleviation. So I would like to ask about money. I don't find it in the paper. So would you put more resources into this, or is just a reorganization of resources? And in the paper, when you talk about functions, that is other than point 16, you say that the COP has implemented a number of promotes the discussion of a number of measures, and you mention ethnic minorities here, but there are no other paragraphs about EM. So would this be a missing link? That is, when it comes to population policy and poverty alleviation, there are different task force and working groups, but it seems that none of them has really paid attention to EMs. So with regard to the employments, and they are actually one of the major human resources in Hong Kong. What will you do? Because now you will have a new platform. What improvements will there be? Now there are different bureaus and departments, so there is no one-stop service for the EMs. Well, some services are provided by the Labor Department, and the HAB will provide trainings, etc. It is quite confusing. So in the future, you will have this Human Resources Planning and Poverty Coordination Unit. Will it play this role? For Mr. Wen's questions, he asked us if we'll be adding more resources to this. Well, for our work, actually the last government has already formed a group to do this, but the group already ended with the last government, so it's also a time limited group, and now we are setting up another time limited unit. Now with regard to resources, there will be additional resources, and paragraph 26 and 27 have told you about the financial implications. So for paragraph 26 is about the two directorate positions, $6.5 million, and for paragraph 27 is about the other staff. So of course there will be additional resources. As for EMs, right, the COP is a policy platform. We also look at EM issues. So from the COP's perspective, we will look at poverty and how public services are used, etc. And we will continue to do this. The COP has analyzed the poverty line, and we are very concerned about EMs. So when it comes to EM poverty issue, we will do an analysis concerning the poverty line. It is being done right now. In the coming 1 or 2 months, we will have a result. And the COP has a task force on special needs groups. We also have a study on EMs using public resources. So all these are being done, and the reports will be submitted to the COP. The reports will also be published. And at the LegCo, there is a subcommittee on EM, so we will also be submitting the report to LegCo. So it will be a coordinating unit. So will it be a coordinator so that there won't be different policies under different bureaus? Yes, for the COP's work, yes, there will be coordination. For what I said just now, involves several bureaus and departments. So the CS would be the major responsible officer, yes. Mr. Jeremy Tam? Well, for this post, they will play a very important role in terms of population policy. And when you talk about population policy, you have to talk about one-way permits. However, for the paper, it's silent on this. Now, every day, there will be 150 persons holding one-way permits coming to Hong Kong. So will you review the quota, that is 150 permits a day? For Mr. Tam's question, yes, well, for the population policy, of course, it would cover this. Because for the one-way permit holders, it's one of our major source of population increase. So when we look at services, etc., of course, we will take them into account. As for the 150 permits per day policy, the government has already stated its policy because it's under Article 22. The mainland authorities have the authority to approve such permits. So for the SAR government, we do not have the power. And there is no grounds for us to suggest changes. Every day, people will come to Hong Kong on one-way permit. So our immigration department will be liaising with their counterparts on the mainland. There are a lot of cooperations. Can the administration tell me, well, under which article of the basic law it is stated that there should be 150 permits? Yes, so it's not stipulated, 150, right? So why can't you discuss with the central authorities about changing this? I find it strange. If it's stated in the basic law, 150, of course, it's not arguable, and we don't have to discuss it here, but it's not set there. Or you may say that 150 is not enough. You can increase it to 250. I'm just asking for a review. I'm not saying that you should work in a certain direction. Well, Mr. Tam, I will continue to answer your question. Yes, we have been cooperating with our mainland counterparts for the quota. Yes, you are right. In the basic law, it is not stated how much the quota should be. The mainland authorities and the SAR governments can negotiate. Yes, you are right. They can negotiate. So how come the paper is silent on this? I will continue to tell you. We have looked at the needs. And every day, well, actually for cross-border marriage, it accounts for 30% of our marriages. So for this one-way permit system, we want to do it in an orderly manner so that families can be reunited. So this is a humane arrangement. I do not want to overrun. I still want to ask questions. Can you allow me to ask questions? Yes, you're right. This is about marriage. A lot of this marriage are fake. But now the approval power is given to the mainland authorities. Okay, I'm not going to argue this with you. So when they arrive in Hong Kong, would you check these people again? Are they really the spouses of Hong Kong people? If they are really spouses, I have no problem that they come to Hong Kong. But there are a lot of fake marriages. In other countries, what would they do? The immigration department would surprise check their homes. Now, if your wife is a new arrival, they will check whether your wife really live with you. Do you have her household items at home? And if there are problems, her temporary visa will be cancelled. In Hong Kong, do we do this? If not, can we do this under the new population policy? Thank you for your question. For the immigration department and the mainland security bureau, they will do a lot of work checking the identities of these applicants. And I've seen the relevant information. If there are suspicious cases, they would check the internal records, they would check the authenticity of documents submitted, and they would even interview the applicant. Well, I mean that after they've got a permit and they've come to Hong Kong, actually there have been some prosecution cases. We also attach a lot of importance to this. We do not encourage fake marriages. Well, they are not the law enforcement agents. They are formulating policies. So the most important thing is whether this post can continue.
Mr. Pun Siu Pei, my understanding
is set for this human resources planning and policy coordination unit. It is led by 2 directorate posts and 10 civil servants would work under them. It is a time-limited unit up to the 30th of June 2022. And as you explained just now, this will come under the Chief Secretary. I'd like to follow up on the following point. The Chief Executive has mentioned that there should be a manpower checklist, and the unit will help with coordination of this checklist. In the election manifesto, she said that the Labour and Welfare Bureau will be in charge of the checklist and the consultant will be engaged. Now, if we have this new HRPPCU responsible for human resources planning, first of all, I want to know whether there is a duplication of resources. Next point, in paragraph 10, you mentioned that there would be an integrated information platform to collate researches and studies so that you can engage students, professionals, etc., to make decisions on their career choices, whether to further their studies. So I want to know whether this platform will be pegged to the existing, say, qualifications framework and the relevant education policies. And it's also in the paper. The Commission will look into the idea of labour importation, how it should be done, or talent admission. We have various schemes, and they come under different bureaus at the moment. So about this unit undertaking these tasks, about enhancing the talent admission schemes, etc., we're concerned about the possibility of importing more labour. So will the unit forward recommendations to the respective bureaus to make arrangements? Ms. Kwan, first on the manpower checklist, in 2015, the government said that the manpower checklist would be formulated. At that time, the Labour and Welfare Bureau was tasked to take this up. And the Labour and Welfare Bureau is in the process of engaging a consultant, as Mr. Poon may be aware, and the consultancy report is almost ready. So they will continue with their work, and once the checklist is prepared, of course, the sectors will be consulted. And then the Commission on Planning of Human Resources will also consider the checklist to see whether it's appropriate before deciding to incorporate the checklist in the government's policy formulation. And about this platform for exchanging information, we've noted that in other countries such as Singapore and European countries, they have online platforms to facilitate members of the public to make inquiries. That means inquiries on furthering their studies, studying abroad, continuous learning, and also training courses tailor-made for the development of certain sectors in that country. And we'd like to use the platform as a model. Say, like Mr. Poon said, there might be the qualifications framework and other training courses provided by other organizations, and also training in particular trades. We would like to collate such information because the training isn't only provided by the government. They may be provided by the private sector as well. And these pieces of information are scattered at the moment. We would like to collate information and focus them on the platform, and we would like to include any special information as well, for the benefit of the general public as well as young people. Third point, about enhancing the existing talent admission scheme. It is in line with the policy population policy on population announced in 2015. In fact, we have put in place a number of enhancement measures. Say, for some emerging industries, we may not have the necessary and the right talents for the jobs. So for the positions requiring specialized skills, certain professions, it is necessary to recruit foreign labor. So together with the population policy in 2015 and the manpower checklist, we can then consider further enhancing our arrangement for importing foreign talents. Labor may not be the labor major issue. This is dealt with under other established mechanisms. When the policy discussion is mature, they will be passed on to the relevant bureaus. Our role is the coordination. I'm sorry, the timer stopped in the middle. Basically, time is up. Mr. Pun Xiuping asked a question on human resources planning and human resources coordination, whether there is any overlapping. That means after the Commission completes its work, you will take over, or are you looking at the same scope of work at the same time? Well, he was asking whether the manpower checklist is a duplication of work, and that's done by the Labour and Welfare Bureau. And as an official member, the Secretary will also be sitting on the Commission as well. So there would be liaison at the working level. Of course, there won't be duplication of tasks. On the division of work, I don't see a duplication either. Next, Dr. Ann Chang. Thank you, Chairman. I have a comment. Dr. K.K. Kwok just now said that the Commission on Poverty previously established did not fulfill its mission and the government has failed to honor his words. I think this is irresponsible because, as we can see, the COP has made recommendations to substantially increase the old age living allowance. In 2013, it was $2,300. Now it's some $3,435, a substantial increase. That was pursuant to a study conducted by the Commission of Poverty, and it was considered to be affordable by the government. And the government has decided to set up this unit to coordinate its work on poverty alleviation. And also another commission on human resources planning. This is welcomed by the DAB. Chairman, on the list of outstanding items for discussion, you can see that I have been following up on the issue with the government. That is on manpower demand projection. And also mismatch in the employment situation in Hong Kong. And I always contemplate this idea as chair of the education panel. It is about our education system. The purpose of education is to let them acquire knowledge and skills to tailor for the needs of Hong Kong in the future so that we cultivate talent. But does our system work in fulfilling this purpose? Let's say for STEM or even STEAM education, the latest coined word, we are gradually but slowly catching up. So about this coordination unit, I think that it will help us tackle changes in our economy and in our population in the future. How should our education system change to support the demand for talents in the future? And I strongly support that. Now about human resources planning, about this commission. Can you tell us the objectives of the commission? Thank you, Dr. Hon Cheung, for her comments. I agree. In relation to manpower demand projection, and our ongoing work is effective. We have the ballpark figures, but when it comes to the breakdown, say breakdown by sectors, by professions, for our policy consideration, our work may not be sufficient. So one of the objectives of the commission is to consider this. We have a commission of or composition of 12. We have economists and also statisticians as members. We did not have such talents in the commission in the last term. So in terms of the data, the last commission was not able to provide specific details, because we only have an overall projection. We can conduct thematic studies. From now on, we can consider emerging trades and jobs and the skills required for these jobs, so that information can be provided to the public. For the training organizations to consider enhancing the training to make up for the shortfall of skills. And with data, we can then look into the development of different areas of our economy. Analysis can be conducted, which is still a small establishment, but we can do it in a more focused way. We can heed members' views and focus on certain industries. Let's say we have a lot of infrastructure projects generating much economic benefit, but we need to consider in greater detail, as far as the labor market is concerned, what jobs are created, so that the public would also understand that there is great potential in taking up these jobs because of the future development. We also need to consider our workforce. Oh, Ms. Kwan, I'm sorry. Please continue with your answer if another member asks, because you've run out of time. It is important, Ms. Kwan, because I was talking to some members from the architecture sector, construction industry today, and as it turned out, in the future, we could have prefab materials instead of building the components on site. Well, Dr. Hon Cheung, please, you're talking about the details. Please save it for exchange on other occasions. Well, there won't be another round because a lot of members have just come in. Mr. Michael, look, 4 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. Human resources and poverty alleviation, they are closely related. If you have good policy on human resources planning, people will be able to get better jobs and get paid more. Otherwise, poverty situation will get worse. So I think we're heading the right direction to combine the two. And this is also the expectation of the labor sector, because we have a lot of potential in our workforce. According to the government, we have 2 million in our population, the potential of which could be unleashed. So we should focus on enhancing training and other supporting measures such as family support and childcare support, and how we could encourage people to work in different districts from their home. And we also have young people who have not received training and who are not in employment. We have several 10,000 such young people, and also several hundred thousand women who could join our workforce. So that's the first point. Second point, when it comes to human resources planning, on the one hand, we have all the merits I covered. On the other hand, we are concerned that the government might be using this as a pretext to expand the SLS supplementary labor importation scheme, and the FTU is concerned about this because we already have abundant manpower, and you do not try to add this element in.
You also have a commission for the planning of human resources. Now, for human resources, we are talking about people working. So the trade unions are actually the most important stakeholders. So for this commission, I hope that more members from the trade unions can be appointed. We understand workers more. We know what kind of people are suitable for to do certain kind of jobs and what kind of trainings we need, etc. Now, you shouldn't lopsided towards the needs of the business sector. The business sector may just try to save money, and as a result, the poverty problem will be aggravated. So in these areas, I hope that you pay attention to them if the coordination unit is set up. And also for artificial intelligence, I think you should also be more concerned about that. Well, the clock is still not working. The time is not up yet. You still have a minute to answer the questions. Well, for Mr. Luke's questions, as for women as workforce, we actually have launched a number of measures to unleash women's potential. We want to help them take care of their families, and we also want to encourage employers to come up with flexible arrangements so that women can take care of their families and go out to work at the same time. So we'll continue to work in these areas. As for the details, of course, the commission will be looking at them. Well, in the past, we have already done some work, and we've seen that more women working. For women between the age of 24 to 65, now the percentage of people working is up to 64.2%. There has already been an improvement. As for mature workers, we are also very concerned about that. We hope that we will prioritize local workforce first. So we attach a lot of importance to local talents. We are not according priority to the importation of foreign labor. As for appointing members to the Commission for the Planning of Human Resources, we of course want to strike a balance, and we want to find the appropriate people to give us views. Just now you've told us that members of the relevant trade unions would have a lot of experiences in this, so of course we will look at that. Well, this coordination unit will be responsible for our population policy and poverty alleviation. I think that is something good, but it's time limited. It will expire in 2022. So we will still have to look at the plans of the next CE. I don't know whether there will be continuity. So before the next term, how will the work be arranged so that we know the work can be continued by the next government? So would you give the work back to the Labour and Welfare Bureau before the new government? Yes, this has already happened when we had a government change this year or last year. And some of the decisions were made by the last COP. Well, the two commissions are still working. So internally, we will try to deploy people to do the work. So we won't suddenly ask a bureau to take up the job of a commission. We hope that can be continuity. And we hope that the new government would also review the work of such commissions. Now, even though this is the second time that we set up such a unit, but we have made some adjustments for population policy. We will focus more on human resources planning, and there will be more economic analysis, and we will rely more on the census and statistics department. So we will be reviewing the focuses of the work of these commissions and coordinating units, and your views will be further considered by us. So would you consider turning this supernumerary post permanent, because we need long-term planning? Yes, we can go back and think about it. I have another question. That's about manpower. Just now, Mr. Look objects to the importation of foreign labor, but as a member of the business sector, we know that there are jobs which cannot find suitable candidates, and for example, carers of elderly. But in the paper, you haven't mentioned too much about this. You say that you hope that there can be a new source of human resources, and you will optimize the talent importation scheme. So you haven't talked about the importation of foreign labor. I think you can explore this. You don't even want to explore. And people will feel hopeless. The government has talked about the importation of foreign labor on certain occasions. So what is your plan in this regard? Now, when we formulate population policy, other than looking at the importation of talents, we have also looked at the importation of foreign labor. And the Labor and Welfare Bureau is now considering certain measures, but we have to stress that it won't affect local workers. The importation of foreign labor is a possible direction, but we also have to look at local talents. We need to make the best use of the local workforce. We want to encourage more people to join these industries. Well, there may be manpower mismatch, and the commission will be looking at that. And the importation of foreign labor will not be the first solution. We will explore different options. Well, you will have a comprehensive planning, right? Yes, we will be looking at it from a macroscopic perspective. Dr. Fernando Chung, Chairman, I'm more concerned about people with disabilities and EMs. Now, for this coordination unit, it mainly assists the Commission for the Planning of Human Resources and the COP. And for these two disadvantaged groups, when we talk about employment and poverty, I think we should really pay more attention to them. In the past, the COP would look at EM's needs and PWD's needs. It has done a little bit of work about them. Last year, you published the reports, but there was no follow-up. So I would like to ask you this. For the coordination unit and the COP, would they do any follow-up work concerning these two disadvantaged groups? And for human resources planning, would you also look at the needs of PWDs, EMs, and the elderly? You're saying that you should unleash the potential of certain areas of workforces, but you haven't done anything. However, you've increased the CSSA limit from 60 to 65. And for the old age living allowance, you also haven't done much. And there are no jobs for the mature workers. Well, the outsourced cleaning companies love to hire them because they can save 5% MPF. So for these disadvantaged groups, would you conduct studies? And in terms of policy formulation, would you try to help them? Thank you for your question. For PWDs and EMs, yes, they are relatively disadvantaged. For our poverty alleviation work, we have that concept already. Well, the COP has already conducted some studies on these two groups of people. And for the EMs in 2014, we issued the first report. And lately, we've conducted a census, and now we have some data. We will conduct another study on the poverty of EMs. We hope that our reports can be published as soon as possible. So we will look at the forms of poverty and the characteristics of EM households, etc. So we will be coordinating among different bureaus, and we hope that we can come up with measures to help them. As for PWDs, that's the same. A few years ago, we conducted a study on the poverty of PWDs. We have made some analysis. As for this year's policy address, there have been a number of measures to help PWDs. So will you conduct another study with your new data? Yes, but we will have to talk to the LWB and their rehabilitation units, and also we will have to talk to the Census and Statistics Department. We will update the relevant data on a regular basis, and the Commission will be looking at them. I hope the data can be updated as soon as possible. Employment is also very important. They cannot find jobs, that's why they are poor. And there should be support measures. Time is up. Ms. Kwan has promised that for their future work, they will also include PWD and EM employment. Next, Mr. Kai-ming, if no new member enters, I'll draw a line here. Well, for the Liberal Party, it does not support universal retirement protection. We think that for the needy people, we should give them more support, but for those who do not have a need, you don't have to give them goodies. Our view is the same as that of the government. In the paper, it is said that for the Commission, it will be an advisory body, and it will be looking at the future planning of human resources. Well, when the government talks about human resources policy, why doesn't it look at the development of different industries first? Now, if you invite people from the business sector to sit down with you, it's difficult for them to tell you how they will develop in the future and how many people they need. But when they do have a need, you cannot provide them with the relevant candidates. So I think the government should be more proactive in terms of industry developments. Then you can be more forward-looking, because when the industry needs talents, there is no supply. Just now, some members say that they are worried about the importation of foreign labors, but don't cheat yourselves. Well, nowadays, we lack manpower in a lot of industries, and for certain industries, local young people would not join them. For example, elderly carers and sailors or other people working on vessels. How about professional drivers and construction workers? There is a serious labor shortage. And I've told the government that if this is not resolved in the coming few years, our ferry service will be affected. And even for our green minibus service, we may not have enough drivers.
That's why I think the government should be proactive. The government could explain more often to labor unions. We should deploy more resources to train local workers so that they move up the chain and take up more value-adding jobs so as to earn a high income. That should be the policy to go. Instead of saying no outright, I'd like to reflect this view to the government. Don't just turn away and say that there is no problem. But of course, I agree that it should be done with priority to protecting local employment. But now we are in full employment. Just talk to members representing different sectors, like Mr. Tommy Cheung. They want cash, they don't want to sign contracts, or they may not want to receive a higher income because of the concern of exceeding the means test for PRH application. There are different concerns as far as the grassroots are concerned. We need to enhance training for them. I think this is the way to go. That's a comment from me. Thank you, Mr. Yu. Next, Mr. Xu. Mr. Leung Yu Chung entered. After I draw the line, I will give you 2 minutes to speak. 4 minutes, Mr. Xu. Now, in terms of human resources planning and poverty alleviation, if the government could take a macro approach and a high-level approach in its reform, of course, it is a good deed. In fact, at different panels and committees, I have been criticizing the government on its human resources management, be it healthcare professionals, carers in homes, etc. There is something seriously wrong about the government's manpower planning, such that we have a mismatch. Sometimes we have the site ready but not the manpower. Sometimes it's the other way around. On poverty alleviation, we have a poverty population of over 1 million for elderly services and also other people who suffered from poverty on a long-term basis. We need the government's coordination. I agree. However, experience tells me that when it comes to coordination in the government, it is nothing but a waste of resources and manpower. Take Commission on Poverty as an example. The government, after repeated discussions, set the poverty line. But after that, the government said that it's a poverty line, not a poverty alleviation line. And the line doesn't really reflect assets. But if you'd rather calculate people's assets instead of poverty situation, what coordination work can you really do? I'm frustrated because when it comes to management and coordination, and I'm sorry, since you're here, I must take you to task along with Dr. K.K. Kwok, because the government commissioned two independent consultants to conduct a study, and then after the studies, the professor was criticized as being ignorant about the use of public money, and then these reports were just put on the back burners. It's nothing but a waste of resources and time and manpower. That means you don't need coordination at all. You don't need any consultancy at all. So you're asking the Legislative Council to provide extra funding to take up the work of coordination. I don't see what coordination can be done because it is still fresh in our mind. After conducting consultancy studies, these reports are put on the back burners, and the government even mocked the scholars. I'm not going to support this proposal unless you're willing to take a closer look at Professor Chow's report, unless you're willing to implement universal retirement protection. Ms. Kwan, I heard Mr. Xu's comment. I believe the government's position is very clear on his stance. That's why I say no coordination is needed. The government's position is really clear. On the matter of poverty alleviation, aren't the government's positions clear? CSSA for elderly, etc. The government says that everything is clear. You want to create two poles for coordination and research? What's that for? We already explained the work of the COP. Well, you have clear position on rent control and rent subsidy. What else is available on the table for consideration? Well, I answered Dr. KK Kwok before when it comes to the poverty line. As we explained, there are limitations. Well, we'd like to continue with this work. There is still room for improvement for this analysis. There is always room for improvement so as to accurately reflect the reality. Mr. Eddie Ju, 4 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. 3 questions. First, I'd like to follow up on Mr. Jeremy Tam's question on reviewing the one-way permit quota. You mentioned cross-boundary marriages. It accounts for 30% of the total marriages in Hong Kong, and that is why you don't see a need to review the situation. Or, to put it in another way, there is an actual need to impose a quota of 150 on a daily basis for one-way permit. But I want to know what the indicator is for the government to kickstart a review. Let's say when certain factors emerge, you would review the number of you would review the quota to increase it or to decrease it. Next, on manpower planning. In the government study, you could consider both geographical factors and spatial factors. Because we have a lot of major planning works. In Hong Shui Kiu, NDA, for example, it is estimated to create 150,000 jobs. And also in another NDA, even 300,000 jobs. Human resources planning are very much related to where jobs are available. But I haven't seen any credible studies from the planning department. What jobs they are? Why 150,000? What are the job types? How probable it is? And it is related to this post you propose to create. So, I think it goes beyond the types of jobs and also the rank or the titles of the jobs. You should include the geographical factor as well. Point number 3, Mr. Xu Ka-chun asked whether the government has a clear position on rent control. Is it really this clear, such that no more discussion is warranted at the COP meetings? Ms. Kwan, thank you, Mr. Zhu, for your questions about reviewing the one-way permit quota system. I want to stress that the one-way permit quota is not really under the purview of the CS4A's office. It's under the Security Bureau's purview. So perhaps I will relay your view to the Security Bureau. I must say I am not involved in this part of work. About factoring in geography, in our human resources planning, and job matching, we also agree with Mr. Eddie Ju. In the future, on human resources planning, in light of major developments, we'd like to conduct more studies as well. But of course, we need information from other departments. We agree that we could explore along this direction. On rent control, the Commission of Poverty, every now and then, will discuss this suggestion. And after exploring the issue at the meetings, it is agreed that since housing supply cannot be increased substantially in a short period of time, introducing rent control may not be the most effective way of lifting people out of poverty. Is it possible that this unit will propose a study on rent control? Not from us. So who should we go after? The Transport and Housing Bureau? Yes, that's a division of work. Last member to speak for 4 minutes, Mr. Ho Kai-ming, followed by Mr. Leung Yu-chung, just 2 minutes. I don't have strong views on the creation of these two posts, but since you used the term human resources, I'm afraid that you might consider Hong Kong people as human resources rather than considering their daily living. We should also consider whether people are living happily, whether people are living in poverty, because there is limited upward mobility and prospect for our young people. It's like the N-shaped society that Japan used to be in. And there is also a gap between the upper class and the lower class. So is there any innovative way of coordinating things? It is true that you should combine human resources with poverty alleviation, but you should not just go after quantity. Don't try to compress the unemployment figures only. For those in employment, you should make sure there is upward mobility so that people living in Hong Kong can be happier. I think you should look into that as well. And is there long-term planning to achieve this objective? Because I don't see any backup. I see statisticians, economists. Will these scholars help look into these social issues? Would it be a better way? What's your thoughts, Ms. Kwan? Is there any vision about this unit? And can we do anything about women? Will there be more measures to assist in childcare? We had some measures. They aren't effective enough. So a number of questions. Ms. Kwan, responding to Mr. Ho's question about upward mobility. That is, if you take up certain jobs, you will get a high income, and then very soon your quality of life will be enhanced. I think the most important thing about human resources planning is industrial development. If you create more high value adding jobs, our labor sector will benefit. But of course, we need human resources planning to tie in with the government's policy and developments. If we could have more of highly value-adding jobs in terms of enhancing employee skills and the provision of training, we could improve both hardware and software by providing more information, and the training organizations would also know the direction that we're heading. So we complement each other. Second point is true that we do not have a large establishment, and we have a small establishment. As such, we cannot take up the work of the whole government. There is room, however, for conducting research. By deploying internal resources, we could say we could engage consultants and also rely on academic institutions to conduct thematic studies. We may not be able to take up all the work ourselves. Well, this committee with the reindustrialization committee, they may be related. Is there any liaison mechanism? Apart from this commission where we have ex-official members, we also have official members. Say the relevant policy bureaus will be represented. And we often communicate with the relevant bureaus and departments. Whenever there are new policies, the commission will also look into them. Mr. Leung Yu-chung, 2 minutes. For this coordination unit, the objective is to enhance coordination and also provide one-stop service of exchange of information to enhance effectiveness. All these sound good. And if you have interdepartmental coordination, it will be good. But my concern is whether there will be overlapping of resources, so that you have superfluous consultations, studies, coordination with new result, and it will be nothing but a waste of social resources, and the efficiency will be undermined.
No.
Well, in the past, we already had the COP, which was chaired by the CS, but the result is the same because it doesn't have the power. It is not a department formulating policies, so you can just make suggestions and recommendations. But if the bureau thinks that these are not feasible suggestions, then nothing will be done. So if the coordination unit is to be set up, it should have power. Now, if we talk about unleashing workforce, the potential of workforce, then how about age discrimination ordinance? Can you force a certain bureau to do it? Do you have the power? That is, if you agree on something, then the bureaus would definitely have to follow through. So do you have the power? As for overlapping of resources, well, internally, when the government has to do things, of course, it has to look at the possibility of overlapping of resources. And with the setting up of the Commission for the Planning of Human Resources, two other commissions works will be incorporated into its tasks. As to whether we have the power to force bureaus to follow up, well, internally in the government, we are just doing coordination. We do not have the power, but we would come up with a lot of reasons. Well, sometimes for the policy bureaus, it's not that they do not want to do a particular thing, but it's a cross-bureau thing, so there has to be agreement. Now, if two bureaus, they might not have agreement in the past on a certain measure. But if we have the coordination units, it may identify certain options. And there can be cross-bureau and cross-sector discussions. And of course, the bureaus have to carry out the work. But if something is really feasible and if the policy can really benefit the public, that can be done. I think it's a matter of interaction. Oh, for COP and policy, population policy, we have already done a lot in the past, and we will continue to endeavor to do better. Well, the CS will come up with policy ideas, and such policies will be implemented by different bureaus. I think the time is almost up, and I don't even have time to ask questions myself, but I hope Ms. Kwan can pay attention to this. When it comes to talent planning, of course, the quality of talent is very important, and education matters. For the importation of talents, well, if in Hong Kong we do not have those talents, and of course that can be done. And I think training and education should be enhanced in Hong Kong so that we have our own elites. And for this item, it is about the creation of a supernumerary post of AO staff grade B and another post of AO staff grade C. And it's from 1st of April 2018 to the 30th of June 2022. So members, do you object to the submission of this proposal to the ESC? Yes, there are objections. For those who support, please raise their hands. So in principle, this item will be discussed at the ESC, because for each item we will discuss several times, first at the panel, then at the ESC, then at the FC. Five members are in support of this proposal. For those who object, please raise their hands. Two. So the majority supports and 3 abstains. So we will submit this proposal to the ESC for discussion. Thank you. We'll move on to the next agenda item. Latest development of the employment services of the Labor Department, paper number CB bracket 2671/17-18/05. The background information is on paper bracket 06. Let's invite the representatives of the Labor Department to come in. And they are led by the Commissioner for Labor. Commissioner, how long will it take you to give us a briefing? Well, just several minutes. Yes, please walk us through the paper then. Thank you, Chairman. I'm very happy to be here today to report to members on the latest developments in the employment services of the Labor Department. Well, we provide free employment and recruitment services. We have 13 employment centers. We also have a telephone employment service center and job vacancy processing center. As of last year, well, because Hong Kong's economy was good, we have a record breaking surface, and the private sector vacancies recorded by LD reached a historic high of 1.4 million. We have also put together a number of job fairs. They are of different sizes, and some are district based, and some are thematic, etc. And for job seekers with employment difficulties, for example, EMs, we also provide them with special services. Ever since May 2017, at our Kowloon West Job Center in Sham Shui Po and Employment in One Stop in Tin Shui Wai, we have hired 2 employment assistants who are proficient in EM languages. And they will be partnering with our experienced employment officers to provide assistance to EMs. And also with the youth employment and training program, now we have engaged some of the trainees to be our employment services ambassadors. And up to now, we have engaged a total of 110 ESAs. As for elderly job seekers, we have implemented different measures to help them look for jobs. For example, we have held talks, and we also have a website providing designated services for elderly job seekers. And also we have some sharing sessions with employers. So we want to encourage employers to hire elderly job seekers. And also we have job fairs for elderly job seekers. Well, most of them may not want to do a full-time job. So for this job fair, some of them are on part-time employment. We hope that we can provide them with more opportunities. So we also have an employment program for the middle-aged to encourage employers through the provision of on-the-job training allowance. The allowance is now also covering part-time jobs. As for job seekers with disabilities, we have a work orientation and placement scheme. In last year's policy address, we extended its work adaptation period from 2 months to 3 months. So we hope that it would be easier for PWDs to adapt to their new jobs, and the employers can also get an allowance of up to $5,500 per month. And from September 2016 onwards, we have launched a two-year pilot scheme. And this is a pilot scheme on counseling services for job seekers with disabilities. We hope that through this counseling service, they can deal with their emotional problems, and we hope that their confidence can be enhanced so that they can settle easier into their new jobs. As for young people, in the second quarter of last year, we launched a new project which is called Career Kickstart. So we work together with NGOs. A 12-month on-the-job training is provided to young people with special needs, and we also have enhancement measures under the new project. The coverage of target group is extended to young people suffering from prolonged employment, and we are also providing placement incentive to host NGOs. And in September last year, we have increased the YETP allowance for pre-employment training courses and workplace attachment training. So we hope to encourage more young people to join the YETP. So these are the latest developments in our employment services. We will be glad to answer members' questions. Thank you. Now it's time for members to raise questions. Let us look at all the Pun Su Ping, Su Ka Chen, Ho Kai-ming, Fernando Cheung, Leung Yu Chong. Each one would have 5 minutes, but you have to be punctual because we do not have a lot of time. Mr. Adichie, I have seen several figures about EM services. That's from paragraphs 9 to 13 here. You talked about 2,844 EM job seekers. They have asked you whether there would be interpretation services. As a result, interpretation services were only arranged on 20 occasions. And there's another figure. 1,036 EMs have registered at your office looking for jobs. I'm afraid that these figures are related. There are 2,844 EM job seekers. You told them that there would be interpretation service. However, only 20 of them got this service. So as a result, a lot of them didn't know what to do and they just walked out, and only 1,036 registered for job seeking. And you haven't given us a figure concerning the success rate. I would want to get that figure. When I look at the previous figures for EM job seekers, the success rate was under 10%, and for the territorial rate is 20%. So what have you done to increase the EM success rate so that it can be in line with the territorial rate? I'll try my best to answer your questions, and my colleague will supplement. As for the interpretation service, if an EM job seeker comes to our center, we will give him a form asking him if he needs interpretation service. According to our past experience, for those who need interpretation service, the number wasn't high. It's about 20. What are the major reasons? First, many of them think that they are fluent in English, and some of them even speak Cantonese, and if they have difficulties, they may have friends accompanying them, so their friends can be the interpreters. So for our employment centers, many EM job seekers would not need interpretation service. However, through CHEERS, we would still provide telephone interpretation service to them. As for the referral service. Maybe my colleague can answer and can give you more details.
Well, let me explain about the job seekers registered, because the majority of our services do not require registration. After the job seekers have registered with us, they don't really need to attend our job centers to use our service, because the job vacancies are all posted online. We talk about 1.4 million job vacancies. In fact, 90% of them are available online. So job seekers can approach them directly, because the methods of contact for employers are also available on the internet, and job seekers can approach them directly. So we do not have a figure whether these job seekers are successful or not, because many job seekers do not go through the Labor Department. Mr. Zhu just now asked about the success rate. For 1,036 EM job seekers who have registered with us, as I said, they might not require referral by the Labor Department. We have a figure, 151 EM job seekers were referred by the Labor Department and were employed by an employer. In 2017, 151 of them received referral from the Labor Department and gained employment. So you don't know the total number. You only know this 151. What about the total? Because for 1,036 EM job seekers registered with the Labor Department, they may not necessarily use our referral service. Next, Mr. Pun Siu-pei. The Labor Department has 13 job centers and 3 industry-based recruitment centers to provide employment services. And I strongly agree that for job seekers with difficulties, more help should be offered. EM job seekers is an issue close to our heart. Just now, other members already asked this question, but may I refer to paragraph 12. Since May last year, the Labor Department has engaged 2 employment assistants who are proficient in EM languages at Kowloon West Job Center in Cham Shui Po and another center in Tin Shui Wai. It's been almost a year. I'd like to have an update about these 2 employment assistants in helping EM job seekers. Are they really following the intended arrangements? And also about the employment program for the middle-aged APM. It's been introduced for many years. I understand that the training allowance of up to $3,000 per month will be provided. Again, I'd like to have an update on the participation numbers of employers as well as employees, and whether you would adjust the allowance amount. Point number 3, about job seekers with disabilities or the placement scheme. The Labor Department will enhance it, and the adjustment of 2 months will be extended to 3 months, and that is for the work adaptation period. And the allowance will be extended from 8 months to a period of 9 months, and it will be introduced in the third quarter of 2018. What is the basis of extending the adaptation period from 2 to 3 months, and also the allowance period from 8 to 9 months? Is it because of the difficulties in implementing the scheme? And would adding an extra month, respectively, help in work placement? And about paragraph 18, the pilot scheme on counseling services for job seekers with disabilities, at the moment, 88 of them already received counseling, of which 53 job seekers concluded their cases. So you have not completed the pilot scheme in full, but have you conducted any preliminary assessment as to whether the scheme is effective in helping job seekers? Well, I defer to the Deputy Commissioner for the details, but let me just respond to members' questions. About the EPM, Employment Program for the Middle-Aged, the numbers have been quite stable over the past few years. In 2017, the number of success cases reached 2,600. And further back, the figure ranged from 2,500 to 2,900. So the figures were more or less stable. Another point on, say, the work placement scheme, WPS, we propose to extend the work adaptation period from 2 to 3 months. The main reason is that disabled job seekers, when getting employed by an employer, would require a longer work adaptation period. Over the past few years, for example, on average, 40% of job seekers with disabilities who received employment left employment in the first 3 months. So 40% of them left their jobs. And then after the first 3 months, the figure continues to decrease. So it has inspired us to think whether a longer adaptation period can be provided so that more support can be given to employers and that the employees can stay on for more than 3 months, thereby increasing the percentage of employees staying behind. That is why we propose to extend the work adaptation period as much as possible to help disabled employees. Perhaps the deputy or the assistant commissioner can take the remaining questions. About the employment assistance for EM job seekers, they are tasked to work with experienced labor officers to provide employment counseling and job matching services. The other task is to find vacancies in a job market suitable for EM job seekers and to contact these employers. The third task is to contact EM groups in the community so that services can be recommended to members in their community so that they are aware of our services. Next, Mr. Xiu Kai-chun. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to give my comment on employment project for young people with acute employment difficulties. About Action S5, it will be regularized and enhanced, and I welcome that because I also got in touch with some young people with employment difficulties, and in many ways they need help. So I think it is important we set up a dedicated system for them, because the market is really competitive and more personal support should be provided. And about the YETP, increasing the amount of allowance, of course it is something good as well. I see that the daily rate has gone up from $50 to $70. Well, in a way, you are reprimanding the Social Welfare Department, because the Social Welfare Department has decided to increase the allowance amount by some $20 per month, and you could increase the daily rate by $20. Now, the purpose of the YETP should be to provide employment service to help them find a job. But what job is it? Will there be exploitation? Will they be working as cheap labor? Will we continue to generate working poor? Of course, the primary consideration is to get a job for them. But what about the secondary consideration? Because you wouldn't want to continue to create the working poor, people working non-stop and yet being paid peanuts. According to the Social Welfare Department in 2016, there is a study for young people in full-time employment from 20 to 34 years old. Over 50%, 460,000 of them, earned less than the median income. They might be in working as salespersons, non-skilled workers, etc. So they mostly would be finding these jobs in the Labour Department. So I want to know whether the Labour Department is actually creating more cases of the working poor. So I'd just like to remind you that you should not focus only on finding a job for these young people, but also care about what job they're doing. Let me explain in greater detail. For example, through the Career Kickstart, YETP, usually, say if we engage an NGO in making arrangements for young people with acute employment difficulties to take up a certain post at work, apart from offering secure and stable employment for the young people, we hope that since they're employed, they can acquire skills at work, they can have greater confidence, and they will also learn about interpersonal skills. These employers may not employ the young people in the long term, but if we provide a one-year placement for the young people, we can help them acquire the necessary skills, such as interview skills, in their future employment, and they will be more confident in the face of their employers. It is also a very important objective. As for the details, I'll defer to the assistant director to explain to you. Thank you, Chairman. About wages, these are internship opportunities. We provide training for them, and on average, the income has continued to increase. From 2009-2010, which is the figure I have, the earliest figure, on average, they received $5,747. And for the latest figure that we have up to December last year is some $9,800. So it's quite a substantial increase. Young people are not only prone to taking low-paying jobs. The YTP offers a variety of jobs in the, say, aviation industry and also e-learning programs. We have these specialized employment schemes to help young people join the industries to their liking. I'm running out of time, Chairman. I'd like to get a written reply from them about the figures they just cited. That is, the allowance, the amount of the allowance, and the actual pay they get in their subsequent employment. Please give us these figures after the meeting. Next, Mr. Ho Kai-ming. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to refer to paragraphs 4 and 5 of the paper about job fairs. Well, this is a major hurdle to importing labor, because if you're unable to recruit sufficient manpower through job fairs, you can then apply for SLS, for foreign labor importation. We do not have many job fairs. In 946 district-based job fairs in 2017, attracting 24,000-plus job seekers, on average, only 25 job seekers attended a job fair. If a job fair lasted for 9 to 5, 8 hours a day, that means every hour only 3 job seekers attended the job fair. For the district-based job fairs, we have 6 of the 3 industry-based recruitment centers organizing 641 job fairs on average. That means every hour only 4 job seekers attended the job fair. If this is the hurdle for importing labor, if you want to protect local employment, I don't think this will do. There are too few job fairs. That means every hour only 3 or 4 job seekers attended the job fairs. How could you give priority to local workers through such a way? I want to know whether the Labour Department is committed to promoting job fairs so that local workers will be given priority. I'd like to hear the explanation. According to labor unions, there are a lot of false or fake job vacancies. For many RCHEs, they offer vacancies and a pay of $12,000 across the whole territory. Why would all the job vacancies be the same? And there are also some organized enterprises that may ask you to take up work in another district very far away from your own. I want to know whether you have conducted any review on whether these are genuine employment advertisements, or rather you're allowing them to use Labour Department as a platform to make bogus employments. So first, so few job fairs, have we conduct publicity? And second, fake employment.
Thank you for your question. For the job fairs, I have visited several of them myself. I didn't have the feeling that only a few persons would enter the fair. So if there are job fairs in the future, you are invited to visit them. I'm sure they are quite crowded. So it's not just like what the member depicted, just several or a dozen persons per hour. And for the job fairs, most of them are in a very busy locations. Well, for the territory-wide job fairs, they are okay, but for district-based job fairs and industry-based job fairs, the number of attendees is really low. Well, for industry-based job fairs, some of them are held at Wan Chai, and some are for catering industries, etc. I've visited them. Actually, there were many attendees. As for job fairs, you are thinking that employers are making use of them. Well, we encourage employers to hire local workers. Well, other than the construction industry, which would recruit overseas labors, and we have recruitment centers for this purpose. However, for other industries, if they want to import foreign labors, they have to meet our requirement. That is, they have to recruit local workers for a four-month period first. So for the employers that are not in the construction industry, when they have job vacancies, they may advertise their vacancies on newspapers. So they will try to recruit local workers first. As for the construction industry, our members would, well, our colleagues would vet the applications, and they have made a lot of effort. They are also very strict. Now, they would go to the job fairs to monitor, and also if local candidates apply for such vacancies, and if the employers eventually decide not to hire them because of their qualifications or experience, etc., then we would ask the candidate whether he thinks he fulfills the requirements. So we will follow up very closely, then we will make an assessment. That is whether the employer has really tried to recruit local workers first. Have you tried to do it undercover? Yes, we can think about doing that, but it's not easy. Now, if you want to pretend to be a candidate, you need certain qualifications and skills. So do we have appropriate people to do that? If you do not have the relevant qualifications, you will be disqualified by the employer very easily during interviews. But we have provide all sorts of services. For example, there are and also for some training courses, we would do some undercover operations. Fernando Chung, Chairman, I would like to ask about the Labor Department's work orientation and placement scheme. You say that in the first 3 months, 40% of the employees would leave their jobs. So you have extended the work adaptation period and the allowance is increased to 5,500 per month. And now you have extended it to 9 months. So have you followed up after 8 months? Well, early on, actually, it was 6 months. That is after the work adaptation period. For those, well, for the PWDs who take part in this scheme, what's the percentage of people that will remain in their posts? Now, the audit has done some work in this area. Well, for the VTC, they also have a program for PWDs, and the graduates took part in the WOPS. 60% of the hired PWDs did not have a job after the allowance period ended. So the rates of leaving their job is 60%. So do you think that some employers are abusing the scheme? Because now you are giving them an allowance of almost $6,000. So they would just pay one third of the employees' wage. And after the allowance period, they would just fire these PWDs. So in the past 5 years, you have several hundred employees taking part in a WOP. So what's the wastage rate per month? We do not, well, we have the detailed figures. The trend is that, well, when a person works in a position longer, it's more likely that it would leave the job. Well, for the first 3 months, it's 40%. And in the 9th month, if he is still in that position, well, one third of them would remain in that position. As for the detailed figures, I can provide to members later. As to whether there are employers who are abusing the scheme so that they can get the government's allowance, in our analysis, we do not find such a phenomenon. Well, many employers who take part in this scheme are actually trying to discharge the social responsibility. They want to hire PWDs. I'm sorry, Commissioner, because time is limited. Well, if we give employers allowance so that they can hire certain people, and if this period expires, so let's say if it's 9 months, then only one third of the employees are still there. So would you think this is a successful scheme? Because we hope that with such allowances, the PWDs can get a job. But once the allowance period ends, most of them would not be hired anymore. Well, this scheme has been in place for a number of years. However, I've never seen a single review report, not a single one. As for the figures, every time we have to ask for them. It's not that I'm not supporting you. I'm not saying that you shouldn't give allowance to employers as an incentive to hire PWDs. But is it effective? Have you done enough follow-up work? Because we want the jobs to be stable, to be long-term. It's not that we give allowance to the employers, the PWDs will get a job. Once the allowance is gone, they will be fired. This is not what we want. And for the CSB, it has the responsibility to employ more PWDs. But in the past, the rate is very low. It's just like 1%. That is newly recruited civil servants. PWDs only account for 1% of newly recruited civil servants. Well, the commissioner said that he has the relevant figures. So for PWDs, employment rates, the income levels, and how many of them would remain in their positions after the allowance period, etc. Can you provide us with this information? Yes. I would like to supplement, Chairman. Yes, we have followed up on these cases. That is, for the PWD employees, why do they leave their jobs? There are several reasons. Well, maybe they find another job, or the performance may not meet the expectations of the employers. So we will talk to the employers and employees. We would ask the employees, do you agree with the employer's assessment? Sometimes they understand that they may not meet the expectations of the employers. But for the other information, we can provide them to members after the meeting. I'll extend this meeting for 15 minutes. Mr. Lang Yu-chung, I have a very simple question. Well, the workforce in Hong Kong is very worried about the importation of foreign labor. So there has always been a major concern. Our unemployment rate is only 3%, so it's not a problem in Hong Kong at all. As for job vacancies, it's 1.4 million. So it reflects that there are a lot of jobs that are not filled by people. However, at the Labour Department, some of the jobs are not real. Yes, that may be a registered job vacancy, but when you call that office, nobody answers, or they would just tell you that the job vacancy is filled. So don't just give us the figure of 1.4 million. Is it a real figure? We are worried that these are just fake figures. Now, I think you must have verified the figures, but I hope you would do more. According to your record, are these posts real? Have you followed up on this, Commissioner? Thank you, Chairman. Well, after job vacancies are filed with us, of course, we will try to verify the information. We will look at their employment conditions, try to find out whether they are reasonable, whether they are lawful, etc. And when a job vacancy is publicized, actually, it's all very transparent. It would be put online. What's the pay level? There are also telephone numbers and address. And if a candidate finds out that there is no such job vacancy, of course, we will follow up. We will talk to the employer. Is there really such a job vacancy, or maybe that vacancy has just been filled? Because each day we will have 5,000 new job vacancies. And sometimes after hiring a person, the employer may not inform us immediately. So when an applicant calls, he may find that the job vacancy has already been filled. So once we discover that the vacancy is filled, of course, we will remove it from our webpage. And if we find that the employer is actually a fake one, he will be put on our blacklist. I don't know how many workers would tell you what their job-seeking result is. Well, it's no point lodging a complaint with you afterwards. So I'm worried that these figures may not be real. Do we really have so many job vacancies? You may have verified the business registrations, but it doesn't mean that the job vacancies are real. Well, it seems that we have most job vacancies in the construction industry, but actually in the elderly homes, we have even more job vacancies. But the elderly home operators want to hire imported laborers. This is our worry. Do you want to add anything?
Commissioner, we understand Mr. Leung's concern, and as pointed out by the Assistant Commissioner, we have a mechanism to verify the figures, and this may serve as your reference. We have checked the trend in previous years. This year we have 1.4 million job ads, a record high, but if we look at the figures in the past decade, you will understand the trend. Let's say the figure may include vacancies that may not be genuine. You can still check the trend in the previous decade to see the situation in the job market. Well, I don't have a question per se, but I do have some comments. Some members have expressed concerns about fake job advertisements, and they would like the Labor Department to follow up on these matters, and about employment for mature job seekers, more should be done. We do not have a statutory retirement age in Hong Kong, and this may be difficult for the department because we have not even discrimination law against somebody's age. So much should be done, similar to employment for EM job seekers. Can you provide flexi hours? Can you provide a greater variety of jobs for them? Because for the silver hair job seekers or mature job seekers, they may have a lot of specialized skills, but they would like to take a slower pace. And on the other hand, some employers may only be able to offer part-time jobs, and we could help with job matching in this regard. I think members also understand the difficulties facing the department. At least, however, you should conduct evaluation on existing programs and schemes so that you can find ways to improve them. Thank you. So that concludes today's agenda. Anything under AOB? If not, then meeting's adjourned. Thank you.